that the Quartus tools seem a bit daunting and you've been subjected to a fire hose, and that's totally my fault. It's also kind of an opportunity. I'll just say, I only have so much time, and hopefully you guys can start to get some idea of how all these things connect. A few recommendations as you're doing the lab. Number one recommendation, please don't mess with the project. I know I've said it many times, if you did any of the reading at all, you want to open Lab 8's archive and begin from there. As you progress, if you want to save it, the way you save it is to archive it, really. Go to Project Archive, and that's where you can then take that file, name it whatever you want. If you expand that, it has all the goodies in it, okay? But when you get to lab this week, I want you to, within moments of starting, open that up, compile it, program it, and see that it's actually working. There's too many heartaches where I know people have spent like 2 hours working and their project's messed up and kind of like all their work is, it's either I or somebody that really knows what they're doing has to sort of save the day, or you have to start over, which is really bad, okay? So just, this is kind of different. There's lots of settings that I'm just giving you. It's kind of like, here's the sandbox, you play in here, okay? But don't go outside the sandbox, very bad things happen, okay? So notice, and what I would say is all these inputs and the outputs, don't delete them. Don't delete them. You can disconnect them. You cannot use them, but don't delete them because you may want them later. Again, the Mega Wizard is the best way to find things. If you're not sure, like, where is that? I don't know. Dig around for a while. If you can't find it, raise your hand, and Dr. Fong or Mrs. Fredette can help you with that. And I'm around too. I love to help students during Lab 8. It's one of my funnest things. I don't always have as much time as I would like, but if you have time, I'll try to make time to help you. Understand this as well, that Lab 8, if you look on your schedule, you'll see that there's Lab 8 and Lab 8B. Now, at Lab 8B is basically, if you don't finish this week and want to continue working, you can come back next week. That's not a reason to slack off and not make any progress or whatever, but I know people say, man, I'm not sure I can understand what's going on here, and I know your progress is going to be kind of slow, but that's why I intentionally gave you kind of 2 weeks to do Lab 8. I think it's really fun. Some cool things have been done. I want your creative juices to flow, and you feel like, hey, I think I get this, and I don't want the tools to be the thing that stop you. So I get that. I know that this is, you know, a lot of things that are different, but anything you can do in Cedar Logic, you can do in Quartus, and there's a lot of things you can do in Quartus that you can't do in Cedar Logic a lot faster. Okay. Yes, Julie?
What do the Lab 8 report do after the second week?
Correct. So it's 1 week after you complete it.
Okay.
So if you are done the first weekend, don't come back the second week, then it's due 1 week after.
Okay.
But if you're actively working on it, then it's 1 week after you're done.
Okay, thank you.
Yep. So, any questions on this? One thing that can be very good is just that you have like a consult with me, and I can help point you in the right direction and get you. Some things just people dream up are like, well, that'd be easy. And other things, it's like, no, that's not easy. But please think in terms of muxes, decoders, counters, you know. Things don't happen by magic, right? It's all logic in there. And there's some neat stuff. Okay, so today we're really going to cover two things. We're going to talk about the washing machine controller and the traffic light controller. So two homework problems. And what this is kind of, this is powerful. You are at the stage right now, you finished test two, right? We know how to do combinational logic, we know how to do sequential logic. Now I'm going to try to show you like the best of both worlds. I'm going to take the best goodies from combinational logic, the best goodies from finite state machining science, put them together in a really practical controller. And what I'm going to show you today, I hope you can see, someday you might want to control something else or some mechanism. Senior design mechanism, we're supposed to fold this thing, we're supposed to, run a CNC machine, do something. And there's different steps and pieces to it. What I'm showing you today can generally be adapted to almost anything. So, let's make a couple observations. So I think we've all, hopefully, how many people have washed clothes in here? Okay, almost universal. That's pretty good. So this is a washing machine, of course, and notice we got a lot of inputs, lots of outputs here. Now, if we were just counting, obviously a fire station machine has to have a clock. It has a start, a cancel, a tub empty, tub full, and a timer done. So if we even just, the cancel's kind of like a reset, but we'd have one, two, three, four. How many arcs would exit every state if we use this traditional finite state machine with four inputs? 16 arcs would exit, right? Yikes! Now, what I found in really, when Christ said you cannot serve two masters, it's true, okay? You can't have, 16 things you're worried about all at once. At any stage in a process, think you're like, okay, I'm going to bake cookies. It's kind of a process. Well, right now, I'm caring about maybe the flour, right? I'm going to measure the flour out. Now, in a minute, I'm going to care about the sugar, but, and the eggs and all that. But at any one step in time, what am I going to do? I'm going to measure the flour and then put it in. Now, I've accomplished that step, and I move on to the next step. Okay, now we're going to get the sugar, let me get it right. You would put the sugar and the shortening, the butter, first, right? And then you cream that. That's what you really do. You do those two things. Then, anyway, there's a sequence, right? But I'm not caring about everything all at once. And most things that we make, especially, we're engineers. God can do things that are all over the place, but we usually have to do them quite systematically, one thing after another. And so really, we only care about usually one thing at a time. Maybe it's like, okay, I'm going to measure the sugar and the butter, and if the phone rings, I'll answer the phone, right? But I'm really not thinking about everything else that's going to go on. So maybe something that would interrupt the process I would care about, like an asynchronous reset or something like that, but usually I'm just going to progress along. Does that make sense? A lot of real practical machines are done this way. So you're going to see how this thing could actually handle even more inputs than this. We can handle 15 inputs, I don't care. But as long as I only care about like really one at a time, it's no problem. And we'll see, there's lots of outputs in this machine. Each one of those would take a K-map, right, using our traditional setup. Now, if we think about it, this machine is going to end up having about 10 states, okay? So if I had 10 states, how many flip-flops would that require? Four, okay. We'd have at least, even if we said, okay, well, the cancel's really going to the reset, so I'm just going to have the start, the tub full, tub empty, timer done. That's four inputs, right? You see I'm already up to an 8-variable K-map. You guys happy about this? No, I wouldn't be either, right? 256 squares on this K-map. I mean, it's like, we're not going to have to solve any K-maps today. Zero. Okay? We're just going to be thoughtful. We're going to think about how this can happen. Not to say that everything we've learned so far wasn't important, but I'm just trying to say, we're going to see how we can put these pieces together in such a way that it can be very predictable and pretty easy, honestly. Because of the structure, it's going to make it easy for us. Okay. I could have somebody read this. Would you read this for us?
Sure. Design, build and test a Cedar Logic, or in Cedar Logic, a finite state machine that will control a simple washing machine. The washing machine has the following wash cycle: idle, fill tub, agitate for 10 minutes, drain, fill tub with rinse water, agitate 5 minutes, drain, spin dry for 5 minutes, idle. The washing machine has the following inputs: start, tub full, sensor, tub empty, sensor, 5 minute timer, which has one reset input and one timer done output. The machine has the following output control signals: hot water valve, cold water valve, agitate motor on, spin dry motor on, drain valve.
Okay, so that's the system. We're going to do a fairly, we're just going to do one. One can imagine fancy washing machines have multiple cycles, delicate and, heavy and all that. But we're just going to stick with a pretty straightforward one. Probably one you do at the coin laundromat or something, right? There's not too many options there either. So, what we're going to do, though, is we are going to develop the state graph. And this is, again, that piece which I say is really of human origin. This is you taking that problem conception and putting it down into a reasonable sequence of events. And don't skip this step. Okay, this is going to be important. And hopefully, though, we're going to write this in such a way that if you showed it to your grandmother, she'd understand it. I mean, you know, we're not going to have crazy just ones and zeros going on. There are quite a few ones and zeros, so maybe this would be a little bit tough, but we're going to give it a nice name, like state zero is idle. We're just waiting for something to happen. Now, we are going to build this as a Moore machine. I like Moore machines. They're predictable. And especially since we're controlling things like the hot water and the cold water, the agitate motor, what if an input like were to toggle? So that we're like turning on, we're turning off, like electrically that can happen really fast. If we do that to a relay or other things, that's like nasty. That's hard on it. It's probably not going to last very well. So having a Moore style output where the output is, you know, it's going to change once. When I'm in this state, boom, I'm there, I'm stable, I don't have to worry about the noisiness of a meter machine. And generally the bad part about a Moore machine was that they got bigger, right? Well, the size isn't going to be a problem. And you can see, actually, that we'll be able to add even more outputs if we needed them. It wouldn't be difficult, and it's not going to make huge state machines, or huge KMAPs. Okay, so we are going to make our key, which I'm a big on, right? So the exit condition will be listed. We're going to use alphanumeric, so we're going to write the name of the exit condition on it, rather than, you know, make a S, B, and all those kinds of things. We're going to list, so this bit right here is going to be the hot water valve, this is the cold water valve, this is the agitate motor, the spin dry motor, the drain valve, and the timer reset. It is low active. So when it's zero, the timer is going to be reset. When we want the timer to go, we'll say one, if that kind of makes sense. So one means go, timer go, zero means don't go. Okay, so here's our idle state. How do we get out of the idle state? Notice the drain valve's open, by the way. So I guess if somebody dumped water in there, any residual water would go down the drain. You want it to go out, not just sit there and stink or something. So, all right, somebody pushes the start button, and we're gonna go to state one, which is fill with warm water. Okay. Does anybody want to finish this joke? I don't know what it is. It'll distract you all, so I'll go on. Okay, how do we know we've completed state one? How do we know that we have successfully filled the tub with warm water?
Full water sensor.
Yeah, we have this tub full sensor, right? So I'm just gonna write tub full, and it's gonna be like this guy right here. Now, how do you think practically you would handle that? You guys are MEs. How would you make a tub full sensor? What do you think, Julian?
Make a float.
A float. Actually, that's a great idea. Just like a bobber or whatever. I know I haven't really taken a washing machine apart to find this. I'm not sure, but I know like in my dishwasher, it is a float. It's this little, kind of looks like a big bobber. It's actually about this big around. It's got styrofoam inside it, and when the water level gets up there, it floats. And it has a little switch on the bottom of it that says I'm there. Now, on that clothes washer, there might be, I think there are probably tubes that are connected to this region, but are not where the clothes is. Okay, that you could have kind of like, and you could probably have some sensors in that. I don't really know. Some people were suggesting, well, how if it had you sensed how much weight it had in it? Not a good idea, okay? In fact, here's something very important that I would encourage you to do. There would be other ways to fill the tub. You could say, I'm just gonna turn the valve on for 5 minutes. That'd be a good idea? Why would that be a very bad idea? Julian?
You can get flow that's like not consistent.
Okay. Yeah, see now, I have a brother who lives in California. I'm gonna go visit him this summer. His daughter's getting married, and so is my daughter, so it's kind of exciting. But anyway, not at the same time, same summer though. And he lives in a place where his water pressure is 110 PSI. That's a lot. Okay, he's just really close to a mountain in California, and they just put the reservoir up on the mountain, so it was cheap to put it up high. Usually we have to build water towers, and they're kind of expensive, and we usually don't get, you know, I don't know what the water pressure is around here, but well, you can look at the water tower, minus the friction, whatever, that's about what the pressure is. But in my house, I'm on a well, and I have to pay to pump my water with the pump, and it's at 40, I think it turns on at 45, or turns off at 45 and turns on at like a 25 or something like that, right? So my pressure's a lot different. So if I did just the 5 minutes of filling the tub, if I take my washing machine at my house and my brother's house, his is gonna overfill, right? And mine might not be full enough. So there's a lot of things that you're like, Here's the bottom line. Just if you wanna have my little piece of advice, I've done lots of robotics, lots of stuff. Sense the thing you care about. If at all possible, sense the thing that you care about, not the derivatives thereof, right? Only do those if you have to. So what do we care about? Well, how much water's in there? That's what we care about, that's what matters. So we're gonna put a little bobber in there and sense it. When it's full, boom, we're gonna trip that. It's gonna send a signal to our controller and it will move on, right? Excellent, okay. So what do we do in the next state? Well, the tub is now full. We're supposed to, what did David read for us?
Agitate,
okay? And I have to kind of say this. Okay, on your homework that I'm gonna pick up here in just a second, could you make a little timer that could count? 5 minutes, 10 minutes, something like that? The keypad counter that you made can do that. Well, we could make a counter that counts two different values. Counts for 5 minutes or counts for 10 minutes. As it turns out, the style that I'm gonna show you, it's probably easier to just pick the lowest denominator and then repeat that rather than add the complication of having to have two timers or have a timer load with a different value. All of those are possible, but since if you looked at the we said we're gonna have most of the things are 5 minutes and one of them is 10. So how about we just do two fives to get 10. That's what we're gonna do. So we're gonna do, I'll call this the first agitate. It's the first 5 minute agitate. I'll give it a nice name. And what would we wanna do? Hot water valve? Off. Cold water valve? Off. Agitate motor?
On.
Spin dry motor?
Off.
Drain valve? Off, and timer reset,
on.
We want to say go, timer go, basically. So we're gonna, here it was reset, here it's gonna be go, okay? All right, how do we know that we've agitated for 5 minutes?
Timer.
Yeah, so we let the timer run, so he's click, timing going on, and we're gonna get this time over signal that says he's done. Okay, we'll build that in a little bit, but time over, 5 minutes has elapsed. Now this next state is gonna seem weird to you, but there's several things that I just wanna demonstrate today, just of kind of a practical nature, and this is one of them. There's different ways that I can build this timer, and I'm gonna come back and show you the two different ways, because we're gonna use one style of timer on the washing machine, I'm gonna show you a different style of timer on the traffic light controller. But with this particular timer is going to be what I'll call more of a master slave, where it's a slave device and it's going to count 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then it's going to basically stop counting. So it's going to kind of like raise its hand, and hopefully the master, which is really our finite state machine, will do something about it. In this case, that do something is to reset it. So what we're going to do is, this is just a timer reset state. It seems a bit unnecessary maybe at first, but we need to. So I don't want to interrupt anything that's going on except this. So I'm not gonna open or close the drain valves. I'm gonna continue to agitate the motor. It's not gonna change. So the user won't hear a hiccup or anything. It's just gonna flow right through this. And the purpose of this is simply to reset the timer so that I can get another 5 minutes. Now, how do I know that the timer reset has happened? What should be on this arc taking me to state 4? A little bit of a trick question.
Nothing. Nothing. It happens instantly.
Excellent. Exactly right. Nothing. This is an unconditional assignment. We will spend one clock cycle in here, which is a very small amount of time, but long enough to get our timer reset. That's all it has to do. And now we're ready to do the second one of these. So this is going to be second 5-minute agitate. And all of it, it really looks identical to this. Now I am kind of forcing something upon us here that is a different way of thinking. Because another way of thinking, you could have said, well, let's go here and then just go back to this one. Right? I mean, in a way, that's kind of the same thing, except I would just do that forever. So then I have to have some sort of other exit condition. As it turns out, the method that I'm showing you, it's much easier to just add another state. States are pretty cheap, and usually we don't need that many. So that, you know, breaking it up into several, even though they're very similar, and this reflects the real world. I just want to say, baking cookies, controlling a machine, whatever it is, usually it's one step followed by another, and we'll just need it. Okay, how do I know that I've accomplished my second 5 minutes of agitate?
Timer
over again, right? Timer over again, timer done. We want to call that. I think on the other slide I called the timer done, but here we call the time over. All right, so we have, our clothes was in there. We agitated for 10 minutes, it's nice and dirty. What should we do? We should. We will want to reset the timer. We're draining. We want to drain this dirty water out of here, right? The soap in the water, it's all yucky, let's get rid of it. So this is going to be the drain state. Main wash drain, and we don't want to put in hot or cold water yet, right? Agitate motor, we should turn it off. We don't want to spin dry, but we do want to open the drain valve, correct? So we're going to open the drain valve, say, hey, let that water out. Now, in a real washing machine, I want to say that the drain valve and the pump would probably access together, right? You have to pump the water out. We're just gonna kind of put those into one thing. But it'd be easy if I wanted to have a second thing here, which is the pump. So, now here's what we're gonna do. Anytime we're not using the timer, we should just hold it and reset so that when we want to use it, it's ready to go. Because otherwise it's just kind of you could kind of say, well, isn't this sort of a don't care here? And it is, but as you're gonna find out, we're not gonna use any K-maps. Don't care is really not going to help us at all. Okay, we might as well just play it safe. How do I know that I'm done draining?
Empty.
Yeah, we're going to get a tub empty sensor. It's going to give us this thing will fire off and say there's no more water in there. We're done. that would do it. Okay, so now we have wet, somewhat clean clothes. Well, what do we need to do next? We need to fill with cold water to do a rinse followed by a rinse agitate. So this is going to be a rinse fill. And we are going to not use hot water. How come we don't use hot water on the rinse?
It's expensive.
Say again?
It makes more bubbles if you put hot water in.
More bubbles with hot water. That's interesting.
Maybe.
It's easier on the clothes, I think. Hot water can be a little bit tough, especially on reds. It kind of fades them and stuff like that. What else? There's another really big reason. It's unnecessary, good. Cost, right? Do you know how much hot water costs? It's one of the more expensive things that you do in your home. So if you're, many of you guys take long showers, right? You all know that, short showers. You know? Especially if you go overseas to other countries, do not take long showers. Don't be an ugly American. You know about that. Anyway, yeah. So we don't want to waste energy. We're gonna rinse with cold water. We don't want the agitator spin dry motors coming on. We certainly better shut the drain valve, or we won't be very successful at filling it. And we should hold the timer and reset anytime we don't need it. All right. So how do we know that the rinse fill is done? Tub is full. Doesn't this just make sense? It's like you don't have to pull out your hair, you don't have to think too hard, you just have to kind of like, hey, I have to know what I want to do. And that's about all. And that's nice, because you usually do. When you built the machine, you know what it needs to be controlled. And it just sort of makes sense. So what are we going to do here?
Agitate.
Yeah, this is going to be a rinse agitate. And it's going to be very similar to these other agitates over here, right? We want to do the same thing, no hot or cold water, agitate motor on. We don't want the spin dry or drain valve to be open, but now we do want the timer to go, right? So we're going to release the timer, and it's going to start counting. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 minutes. And when 5 minutes has passed, time is over. And now we've got the nice rinse water all there. We should get rid of that, right? So now we want to do a rinse drain. And then there's kind of a repeat, but that's how it works, right? That's what we want. So for all the same reasons here, we'd want to have those as our outputs, right? Just basically open the drain valve, everything else is turned off. Might as well reset the timer. Now we know that the rinse drain will be complete when the tub is empty, right? And S9, our final state is the spin dry. This is our spin dry. So this is the only place in this thing where, we want to put a one here, where this spin dry motor is turned on, isn't it? And we want the drain valve to be open, and we want the timer to run. And we're going to be done here when the timer's over, right? And we're back to it. We should have clean, wet clothes, but they've been as dry as we can make them through spin dry. Okay, great. So, can you imagine later you have some other machine you want to control? Could you kind of set it up here, label the parts, what's the exit condition, what are your outputs, those kinds of things. So, let me, you have that, keep that handy. I'm going to erase this and go to the next page. So, actually, I guess I can be right on the last one. Let's take a look at the thing. So I'm going to go to Cedar Logic, and I have this file that you'll want to download on Moodle. It's called Washing Machine Controller, and here it is. All right. Now, you look at this thing, it's like, is this overwhelmingly complicated? Yes. You said yes. No, it's not so bad. I mean, yeah, there's some stuff here, but wow, this is pretty good. Now, compared to, would you like pages of 8 variable K-maps? Yeah, no. I want to say this is really not bad at all. Let's start with something fairly simple for starters. I could give you this on the test. It's very similar to the homework I'm about to pick up. Tell me, what does that thing do? How would it respond? Knowing how county registers. Does it reset? Yeah, when does it reset? The timer reset is true. Now notice what I did here, since it's kind of a low active signal, I just sort of cheated by putting a NOR here. We'll get back to this later, but this is the only one that's bubbled if you kind of look at what's happening. It was just easier to do that one. Okay, so if this thing's held in reset, it's just gonna reset, right? When we're gonna load? Never. If we count, we're gonna count up, but we're not gonna count always, right? How can somebody say in words how long we're gonna count?
It's gonna stop counting at 5.
Yeah, when we hit 5, we would stop counting. And we would just hold 5 indefinitely. So what this thing does is you can reset me, and I'm back here at 0. And if you keep me reset, I can't go. It's kind of like a dog on a leash. It's just ready to run, but it's not going anywhere. But as soon as you release it, right, it counts 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then it just quits. Now, this is what I call a kind of a master-slave situation. Why this is kind of important, you really wouldn't have to do it this way, but I wanted to show you the two different styles, because sometimes we really do need this. You see there's a clock here, and there's a clock here. There's two separate clocks. This one might count actually pretty quickly, But this one, like right now as is, it needs to count once a minute, right? If we wanted to do that, we'd have a really slow clock kind of thing. Usually we don't get them quite that slow, but we could by dividing higher speed counters to slower ones until we got it to a minute. And then we count to five. So in this case, we call this kind of an asynchronous situation, two different clocks. They're not in sync with each other. And when you have this problem, sometimes weird timing things can happen. And so it's better to do more of the master-slave idea. Do you remember the little peeps? We wanted to put two pinks and two yellows. Remember how it just hovered forever at the end until it got an external reset? And that's kind of the same style as this. So this thing does what it does, but once it gets to five, it stops and it patiently waits, saying, you see what it's gonna say? Time's up. Hey, time's up. Time's up here. But it's not going to demand that it happen right now, okay? And this is a helpful way to do that. Okay, so this thing, it'll count to five every time, give us a timer done signal, and patiently wait until it gets reset so that it can do it again. Okay, good. All right, now let's study these three parts up here. They're really the heart and soul of this stage. And of course, the heart of anyone would be the counter itself. So if we look at this, when are we going to reset? Cancel. So if somebody pushes the cancel button at any time, it's going to go back to the reset state. Now it's going to be kind of lame, I'll say. I mean, if they do it in the middle of whatever, it's the drain valve will open. It's not going to spin dry or anything, but you can at least get your clothes out and get out of there if you have to, right? I suppose. I mean, it's best we can do under the circumstances. Okay. If we load, when are we going to load? Apparently on done, which is going to come from down here. We'll look at that in a minute. What are we going to load?
Zero.
Now, I could have done something much more sophisticated along the way, but you'll notice in this particular state machine, did it ever make an out-of-sequence jump? Did we ever jump from state 5 to state 9? No, we just went straight on through. I want to tell you, it's amazing how many real-world systems don't have to make out-of-sequence jumps. Okay? You just do this step, this step, this step, this step, this step. Sometimes you get more sophisticated and say, okay, well, you know, if it's hot enough, then we can skip steps 3 and 4, but if it's not hot enough, we'll do them. And we could have done one of those. We could do some loads, and we could add some extra logic right in here to do multi-way branches. I'm not going to actually ask you to do that, but I want to tell you it wouldn't be that hard to do that. Okay, so here, basically, we're going to count, and we're going to count up, right? When are we going to count? Whenever next is true. Do you see where next is? It's right here. So let's take a minute now and just kind of spend some time right in here. How did I figure out what to put on next? Well, yeah, they're just your exit conditions in order. Okay? You could have all kinds of them. In essence, we have 9 states here, or actually 10 states, 0 through 9, right? Which gives us 10 exit conditions. Every one of those could be different. We understand that they could come from a different sensor, a different possibility. We could have 10. I mean, whoa, that'd be 2 to the 10th. That's 1,024 arcs exiting every state, right? But all we do is we just put whatever that exit condition is. So how do we exit state 0? Somebody pushes the start button. I want to show you one other, again, practical thing. I wouldn't have to do it here because it's kind of obvious, but I want to touch on something that you might see when you're out there working. It's in your design project or when you're on a competition team. And I do want you to know about something called, switch bounce. Have any of you heard of switch bounce? Now, The DE2 boards that you guys are working on for Lab A actually are pretty decent. They've done some fairly good electrical circuitry work to try to minimize switch bounce. The Cadet 2s that we have that you guys have been hooking up your TTL chips on, there's no switch bounce suppression in there. And here's what happens. You know those, so if you have one of those switches, right, that can be either a high or a low, and if you were to actually look at that, say you switched it from low to high, you think it did this, and then you switch it back low again. Well, that's not really what it does. what happens is this rocker, it's made of metal, and there's usually springs and a little bit of stuff. As you slide it across that copper, it's kind of bouncing. It is. If you were to zoom in and see, it could make contact, break contact, and kind of electrically, what usually happens is something like this. Okay? That kind of thing, where there's lots of them. And so if you were to take this switch, say, and you just ran it into a counter. So I take the switch and send it into a counter, and say maybe take the counter to a 7-segment decoder, and you display it out here. What would happen if you did that on the cadet? Would it go 0, 1, 2, 3, 4? You go 1, 2, 3? You wouldn't see 1 and 2, of course, because they happen way too fast for you to see anything. And then you flip it down, you might see 7, and then you go A, and then it'd be F, and then it'd be 3. And because every one of these rising edges, you're gonna get multiple counts. It's a real problem. So you say, okay, great. Now that's just because those switches are just cheap. We'll get some really good ones, you know. We'll buy the $15 switches. And by the way, you can spend a lot of money on switches. There are $100 switches out there. So, guess what? They'll bounce too, okay? It's kind of unavoidable. It's just, hey, we live in physics, materials, all that kind of stuff. It has to go from not making connection to making connection. And if you're zoomed in the nanosecond realm, it's going to bounce, okay? But you can spend a few nanosecond for a flip-flop if you have it on an integrated circuit, and it's no big deal at all. What is this thing doing? What is that doing? That's just a D flip-flop. Okay, that's its purpose. It is to defeat switch bounce. Notice, taking a D flip-flop and tying this high and then clocking it, I mean, that's very uninteresting. Right, I'm going to clock it one time, then it's going to go high, and it's going to be high forever. Right, you see that? Well, except for this, right? Because this is going to asynchronously reset this guy anytime we are not in state zero. So state zero is the only time that we could possibly allow it to go on. And all other times it's going to be just held and reset. It's going to ignore everything. But what's really nice about this, will this point right here bounce? No. On the first rising edge of start, no matter how messy or ugly it looks like, right, it's going to load this one. So in essence, what we're doing here is we're really hijacking a D flip-flop and simply wanting to utilize its edge-triggered nature. That's really what we're doing. So on the first rising edge, we grab a 1. This would hold it beautifully fine. Notice, is this synchronized to this? Is when you push the start button synchronized to the clock internal to your state machine? Not at all. And so again, this is one of those, we call them across clock boundaries. There's the clock up here and this asynchronous event down here when you press the button. This can synchronize nicely because you're gonna hold it on fine as long as it takes for him to recognize it. Then we're going to advance to the next stage, at which point we're going to start to clear this thing again. Okay. So this seems maybe a bit like, why go through all that effort? I wouldn't have to in Cedar Logic, but in the real world, it'd be a really good idea. Okay. So switch bounds, be aware of that. Okay, so the start button gets pressed, basically, through this nice mechanism. What's the next arc? How do we get from state zero, from state 1 to state 2? Tub is full, right? If you look on your chart, so all I want you to do is everybody see, we have a pulse here, just look at each of these arcs. So start, what's the next one? Tub full, what's the next one?
Time over,
next one?
Unconditional.
It was unconditional, right? You see how you can do it unconditional? You just tied high. So it's going to spend one clock cycle in there, right? Next one's timer done, empty, full, time. You see how easily that's done? No K-maps involved, correct? Just write down the condition by which it advances. So this has everything to do with the exit conditions right here. A nice little 16-to-1 mux tells us when for our counter to get optimized. Now for the outputs. What do we need for the outputs? Well, what's this guy right here? He's a 4 to 16 decoder, right? And how many of these outputs can be active at any one point in time? Just one, right? And it will tell us what state we're in. This makes the outputs of reads. So, here's what we do. Now scan, you have to scan every single circle in your state graph. When is the hot water turned on? When is it non-zero? Which states? State one, that's the only place, right? So do you see how I can take S1, state one, and send it right to the hot water valve? Boom. How about the cold water valve? Where in all of the states, under what states, is the cold water valve turned on? 1 and 6. Now, as we say that, we really can almost, we need to sort of retrain ourselves. Is it S1 and S6? It's S1 or S6, right, is where that's on. So we use the verb kind of in or wrong sometimes in our thinking of that, but whatever. Notice agitate is true on 2, 3, and 4. Right? Those are our agitate ones, including the reset in the middle, as well as state 7. Is this tough? You figure this out? You see, could I add more outputs to this thing if I had some? Yeah, just tell me which states you want what in, and I'll turn it on when you need it turned on, and all other cases it'll be turned off, right? Just simple OR gates. So, this thing works. You ready? Let's try it. So, here we are. We're in the idle condition. We've dumped our dirty clothes in, we've dumped our soap in there, and we've hit the start button. Notice the drain valve is open and the timer is being actively reset. So we hit the start button. Ta-da! That thing grabbed it, and now we find ourselves in state one. State one, the cold and hot water have turned on, and that's about it, right? Everything else is sort of off over there, which means the drain valve is shut. We're not draining. What would happen to my empty sensor? It should go off after a few seconds, right? Once we get a little bit of water in there, and then the water keeps filling until this full happens. Now, I'm not going to press it quite yet because quite a bit's going to happen once I do this. Then we're going to be based on timing and lots of things are going to happen. These guys should turn off and the agitator should turn on, right? And then it should run for 5 minutes, reset, run for 5 minutes more. Let's see if it does. So I'm going to hit the full. Ta-da. Notice it's agitating. You get to 5. You reset the 1 clock cycle. 5 more, we're still agitating here, right? And then we hold here, and we find ourselves now in state 5, which is draining, correct? So now we're draining that dirty water out. What would happen to our full sensor? It should go off, right? Keep draining down till we get to the empty, at which point we're going to fill with cold water in state 6. So in state 6, the cold water is filling in, so the empty sensor should go off, and eventually the full sensor should go on, in which case we're going to agitate again for 5 seconds. So I'll do that pretty quick in state 7. We go to state 8, the drain valve opens, the full sensor goes off, the empty sensor comes on, and now for the first time we're going to see spin dry happen, right? In state 9, going to do that for 5 seconds, and boom, we're back to zero. We've washed our clothes. Woo-hoo. Oh, yeah. So, that's it. And I want you to see, you understand all those pieces now, right? You have what it takes and you can easily redesign this. Any machine, this thing can handle a machine up to 16 states pretty easily. And I want to say a lot of stuff can happen in 16 states or less. Of a practical nature. A lot of things are going. Okay? So let me talk about the one modification that I'm going to ask you to do for your homework on this. And it looks like this. Mainly I want you to bring it down, play with it, do what I just did, make sure you understand how it's working and why it's working. this is what I'm asking you to do. Daniel, would you read it for us?
Modify the following washing machine control by adding the option of not only a warm water cycle, but also a cold and hot cycle. You will need to add three inputs, a hot, warm, and cold. You may assume that these inputs push buttons are mutually exclusive. Only one can be active at a time, even though in dialogue they will not be. The only state that should be affected will be the state, fill state, S1. Please treat the outputs hot water and cold water as a mealy type outputs from this modification. That is, still only use one state, S1, but create a mealy type logic to drive the hot water and cold water outputs, given the temperature inputs as shown in table one below.
Okay, so what I want you to do, this is actually pretty easy to do. And when I say mealy style, this is actually something my wife likes to do with our washing machine, because like when she's doing the first load, the hot water isn't as hot yet, right? Because it's, you know, it has to pump through all the lines and whatnot. And so she might run it a little hotter at the beginning, but she really wants a warm cycle, so she runs hot for a bit and then flips to warm, and then she gets a different setting on the machine. So within that one state, we can do it. When I say you're gonna have to add these three buttons, cold, warm, and hot, in CedarLogic, these things just are on or off, but think of these like a push-button blender, right? Where mechanically only one can be engaged at a time. If you push this one down, the other two pop up. You know how that works? Now, you just treat it nice here, right? Turn them all on, that would just defeat the purpose, and you don't have to. But if you press the cold water, then it should just fill with cold. If you press the warm, it should fill with both hot and cold, like it was before. And if you have hot, it just fills with hot. Okay? So mess with that. It's basically going to be some additional logic right in here that you're going to need. And it's really not right. Mostly, I just want you to play with it. Okay? Let's go on to the second problem. Here is a traffic light controller. Actually, I need a reader for this one too. David, did you read this for us?
Yeah. Design, build, and test in CedarLogic a finite state machine that will control a set of traffic lights. The machine has two inputs, a crossroad sensor that detects a vehicle is present and waiting to cross the highway, and a timer done signal. Use a Moore style machine with seven outputs, highway, red, yellow, green, and crossroad, red, yellow, green, and a high active timer reset. Your traffic light should stay green on highway at all times, except when the crossroad sensor becomes true. It should then go to yellow on highway for 10 seconds, followed by a green on crossroad for 20 seconds, followed by a yellow on crossroad for 10 seconds, followed by a green on highway for at least 30 seconds. At this point, if the crossroad sensor was again one, the process should start over, otherwise it should hold in highway green state. Use a modification of the washing machine design done in class to accommodate this design. Change the timer to count to 10 and do so repeatedly unless held and reset. This will save many otherwise needed reset timer states. To get 20 and 30 second intervals, simply wait repeated 10 second intervals. 8 states should be sufficient for this design. The first few states of the state graph have been completely completed for you. Turn in this page with your complete state graph and print out with your name on it a working CedarLogic schematic.
Yeah, thank you. So we're gonna have, this is the situation that we're working on. We've got a crossroad sensor here on this small side road, and then there's the main highway, okay? We don't wanna starve the main highway. It's important they get priority, and the crossroad sensor, I guess they'd be in these two locations. And we've got, red, green, yellow for the highway, and we've got red, yellow, green, I guess I should say, facing here for the crossroad sensor. Okay, I said, again, we're gonna just use a 10 second timer, and if we need more than 10 seconds, we'll just do multiple 10 seconds. This timer, however, is going to be different. It is gonna be of a continuous variety. So I haven't completed it here, but this is the starting one. Just like the washing machine in Moodle, there's this right here, which is the the traffic light start. And you'll see the same basic structure. We got our counter, we got our MUX, we got our decoder, and we've got our county register. Now, how could we connect this up so that it, once it counted to 10, it automatically reset and did it again?
You could put in some logic so that when you get a 10 output, it resets this, the counter.
Right. That's what we want to do. And we could do that with, and we can't hold it in timer reset, we could do that. Another possibility, if we have to have timer reset plus that, we would have to put some sort of gate in here, right? That's like or, it resets on timer reset or when it hits 10. Another possibility would be you hit 10 and you load 0, which is the same thing as resetting. Loading 0, kind of like holding, loading yourself is holding. Loading 0 would be resetting too. So there's several proper ways that you could build that. But I want you to just see that this one's going to automatically give you like a timer done. And then it'll go on. But notice the difference. This is a big, kind of a big deal. You see this clock is also connected to here? So we don't have those two clock domain problems. So we're not going to have asynchronous garbage happen to us. So when we have a common clock, then using this technique is very fine. Whereas the other one, we had two clocks, it's a little bit more dicey and should be done the other way. Okay? All right. Got our name of our state. This is the highway green light, the highway yellow light, the highway red light, the county or crossroad green, crossroad yellow, crossroad red, and a timer reset so that we can hold it there. Okay. Notice that, like right here, the timer is being held in reset. And here the highway is green, right? The crossroad is red. And we're just going to stay that way forever until we get a crossroad sensor. Because we don't want to start the highway gets priority, it gets to go at all times. But if a person comes up and lands on the crossroad sensor, then we want it to go to this condition. And what was it? Notice we give a highway yellow. We better keep the crossroads red here. Now, do you understand? Because we have access to all these, could you turn them all on at once? Or turn green and green on and cause accidents? If you can design something, you can design something wrong, right? So don't do that. How many of each of these triplets should be on at any one point in time? Just one, obviously, right? I think there are some countries where they do turn on both. It's like yellow-red. I don't know. We don't need that. So here's highway yellow. And I think we did a couple more, right? So TD here is timer done. And so that was 10 seconds of yellow. And now we're going to give the highway red and the crossway green. How long do they get green? 20 seconds, right? So this would be the, see about this. This is highway yellow, crossroads green. This would be second crossroads green, right? So we want the same kind of thing there. Then what do?
Do I need to reset the timer?
Okay. Good question. How did we make this timer? This timer. It automatically resets. Because it's sharing a common clock and it automatically resets, it will be timer done, will be true for one clock cycle, which is fine because that's what the whole machine is clocked on. So the answer is no because of that. Okay, what's the state? Okay, crossroads yellow, right? Yeah, so this would be cross yellow. And, all right, so we better still have red on the, 00 red, basically, And then we want 010 on the crossroads, giving him a yellow, and we're gonna let the timer go. Now, what, this is kind of an interesting piece right now. I'm gonna do something that's, well, I think we should just go right here. If someone suggested that, you say that's a good idea? Okay, granted, wouldn't that be, I mean, after crossroad yellow, don't we want to have highway green, crossroads red? Okay, now that's a good point. Sometimes you, on real lights, they have them red both ways for a little time. Now, do you think people, what's the smallest delineation of time we have in our system the way we're doing this? Yeah, it's like 10 seconds, right? I don't think people put up with that. Really. Okay, so the answer is, if we had greater granularity and could do it a little better, we might do that. But since we only have 10 second granularity, we're gonna skip that. And we are gonna go instantly. There's not gonna be a double red, which is a safety concern, but we're not doing that. Okay, so we're gonna be fairly realistic without being terribly realistic. No, this would be okay as far as, I mean, it's consistent with the way we're handling other things. What's wrong with doing this?
That, if that happens, then the crossroads could become, like, we have to make sure there's 30 seconds of time on the main highway before it goes back to the crossroads.
Excellent. That's why I did this, to make sure you understand why we can't just jump. Because in a way, it would. How long would we spend in here? Say there's just, you know, Farmer Joe's got all his buddies right behind him here, right? And the crossroad sensor is still going. How much, if I just did this arc, how much time would we spend in highway green? One clock cycle. Okay? I don't think the highway green people are going to, well, the highway people are not going to be very happy with that, right? So you see that I can't do that. What I have to do now is make sure that the highway does not get starved. So the highway gets green three times, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. Highway green for 10 seconds, 20 seconds, 30 seconds. And only after 30 seconds will we again become sensitive to the crossroad sensor. And we have to guarantee that the highway never gets started. Now, it's a little bit of a bummer. I will say, if you know, it was the way it is. What if nobody's on the highway and a bunch of people are on the crossroads? We're gonna have to wait 30 seconds and this tool will go down, right? But we'll assume that that's not the norm. Okay, well, have fun with this. And you can see, I've got these up here. Some people have the green one, you can make green, right? If you wanna do that, that's kind of fun. We can make the red red, right? And can't make the yellow anything, but you can make it blue, I guess, if you wanted to. Or cyan.